Hey, another countdown.
Oh, cool. So what are we doing this time?
I don't know. Feeling pretty mischievous today, honestly.
Yeah, now that you mention it, I do feel rather villainous.
Hey, TV Guide says Wreck-It Ralph's on today.
Hmm, that gives me an idea.
We're gonna steal a news van?
Yeah, wait, what? No.
But it's the perfect crime! How are they ever report it?
Do you listen to yourself when you speak?
Nope!
Top 10 Disney villain songs. William, criteria.
Glad you asked. Songs must be from the main Disney animated film canon. No TV shows or live-action films or direct-to-video sequels. Songs must be either sung by the villain or for the villain in a positive light. If the song is actually mocking the villain, it does not count, so no Cruella de Vil or Phony King of England, stuff like that. Also, no scrapped or deleted songs, and no Broadway exclusives. And just keep things fresh, one song per film.
So, without further ado, here's our top 10 Disney villain songs. Starting off this list is one of the most deliciously devious tunes in the Disney library.
Prince Ali, yes it is he, but not as you know him.
Prince Ali reprise is so damn fun. This is the moment Jafar goes from a standard, brooding bad guy to a gleeful psychopath. Nowhere is this more evident than that insane high note at the end.
Yeah, this song is definitely a lot of fun. It's a nice sarcastic callback to one of the earlier highlights of the film, stripping Aladdin of all his glory, yet it's only a minute long and it does suffer a lot because of that. You guys know the old saying, give a mouse a cookie, he'll want a glass of milk to go with it? That's this song. It does just enough to give you what you need, but abruptly stops. Kinda like this segment. Oh my god, Randy Newman did something right for once.
Don't you disrespect me, little man. Don't you derogate or deride.
Yes, in Princess and the Frog, we got one of the most unique Disney villain songs with friends on the other side.
I've got friends on the other side.
He's got friends on the other side.
The whole song and signals what would happen if Tim Burton took over the office one day and Randy Newman and Danny Elfman made sweet musical love and created some evil music monster.
What?
That was a sense, but you know what? We got this song because of it, so there we go.
This song largely succeeds due to the smooth as hell delivery of Keith David, coupled with the slick dance moves of Dr. Facilier himself. The beginning of the song is smooth, subdued, and sinister, with some great interplay between Facilier, his shadow, and his two guests of honor. And the ending is even better, thanks in large part to the otherworldly sound of the instruments and the vibrant colors and imagery overtaking the screen. But the reason this song is so low on the list is that the middle is kinda boring.
Now you young man are from across the sea. You come from two long lines of royalty.
How long is this going to take?
It's got its own little nice moments of sinister foreshadowing, but for the most part, it's kind of a drag to sit through while you wait for the awesome ending to kick in.
Friends on the Other Side brings on the flair with its high energy and cabaret sound, even if the cards aren't always in your favor.
You can blame my friend on the
Oh my god, Facilier is a Yu-Gi-Oh! Villain!
Oh no! We're walking on eggshells here, guys!
Oh jeez.
Let's talk a bit of history here. Once upon a time, there is a group called the Pilgrims, looking for a new home, and with the help from some friendly natives, they found it. That's when the genocide started. And then hundreds of years later, Disney made a movie about it. And it was boring.
I mean, some people like it.
It was boring.
Oh.
Hey, at least Pocahontas had one cool song with savages. a two-part song showing off the prejudices of both the white settlers and Native Americans. Part 1 just hooks you in, while Part 2 slams you with that sweet multi-layer section with Pocahontas acting as the voice of reason, while the Pilgrims and Native Americans get ready for all-out war. Meanwhile, John Smith's about to get assassinated, but don't you worry, Pocahontas is about to save the day with love!
It's a cool song with breathtaking visuals and colors and an incredible intensity you don't see often in Disney songs. Plus, it taught me that when you combine two different types of smoke, you get lightning. The more you know. With that said, the lyrics aren't really that great.
They're different from us. Which means they can't be trusted.
Wow, that's pretty on the nose there, guys.
The skin's a hellish pit. They're only good when dead.
Oh, just take it easy, man.
The song really does hit you over the head with the message of racism is bad. Don't be a dick. So when the song hooks you in, it's pure adrenaline. Okay, this next one might be a bit controversial since this is one of the more beloved of the Disney villain songs, but hear us out real quick.
I admit that in the past I've been a nasty. They weren't kidding when they called me, well, a witch.
Hear us out. Put the pitchforks and torches away. We still like the song. It's catchy, it's dark, it's everything you'd want in a villain song. It's the de facto example of how to do it, which makes sense because Little Mermaid was the first film of the Disney Renaissance. Story-wise, it does a good job of showing off the main villain. The song starts out nice and quiet, going light and beckoning, before becoming dark, powerful, and menacing as Ursula takes Ariel's voice, advancing the plot just like any good musical song should.
Make your choice. I'm a very busy woman, and I haven't got all day. It won't cost much. Just your voice.
And outside the film, it's still fun to listen to. But
as much as I love Poor Unfortunate Souls, I feel like it's just a bit overrated. Much like Friends on the Other Side, I think the middle section is just a little too slow, though to a lesser extent. It's still pretty fun, thanks to Ursula's incredibly devious personality, voice, and
body language.
It all really shines throughout the entire song. But that ending, though, takes the cake.
Yeah, this next one might be a bit of a cheat, since technically Nightmare Before Christmas was released under Touchstone, but it is officially owned by Disney, as they will remind you every October, so it counts. And boy, is this one a trip.
The hellish land of nightmares and monsters. What kind of villain are you going to get?
Ooh, what about a giant Satan beast? No, okay, what about a mashup of slasher villains? No, okay, what? Cowboy in a burlap sack? Wait, what, really? Okay, sure. Oogie Boogie's song is a jazzy piece where the boogeyman verbally assaults Santa Claus and just revels in his debauchery.
Debauchery!
You're joking! I can't believe my eyes! You're joking me! You gotta be! This can't be the right guy! He's ancient! He's ugly! I don't know which is worse! I might just split a seam now if I don't die laughing first!
The visuals are great, the melody is very fun yet menacing at the same time. I really enjoy Oogie's voice crack for some reason. It's just great. For a film that kind of plays fast and loose with a lot of the melodies in its songs, this one is the complete package. Catchy, harmonious, and completely bonkers.
The casino hashtag aesthetic gives the scene a drastically different feel from most of the songs in the film, which is quite the accomplishment since Nightmare is different from most Disney films. For a giant potato sack filled with cockroaches and worms, Oogie Boogie has style. The catchy tune, and as Oogie puts it, does the best it can.
What are you going to do?
I'm going to do the best I can.
When talking about Disney villains, you'll tend to get a lot of the same results over and over. Everyone's going to talk about how great Scar, Ursula, Jafar, and Frollo are, how badass Chernabog looks, and just how evil Cruella de Vil can be. But there are some villains who are a bit more understated, just because not many people really think of their motives and consider them as villains. Case in point, 1967, Jungle Book. Who are the villains in the movie? You're probably thinking of two characters right now. The bloodthirsty Shere Khan and Ka the Snake. Oh, so Trust in Me is on the list, right? There is one other villain in the movie, and it's someone you probably didn't even think of right away. King Louie. And he has a swinging number to sing to you.
Now I'm the king of the swingers, oh, the jungle VIP. I've reached the top and had to stop, and that's what's bothering me.
I've never even seen the original 1967 movie, but this song is something I've listened to over and over. It's so catchy and fun, even if it's not really a villain song in the traditional sense. I like Christopher Walken's version on the soundtrack of the 2016 remake, but in the movie it's kinda out of nowhere and, quite frankly, it's pretty embarrassing. It just doesn't work with this gigantic, monstrous ape who could crush you at any second. I mean, it just feels so dumb. I mean, at least they don't do anything else stupid. The cowbell? What? Okay, that's the dumbest thing I've ever seen. That's it. This song is off the list. We're done.
You don't want to talk about the original version of the song, right?
Oh, yeah.
Now, back to what I was saying earlier. You guys remember why he kidnapped Mowgli in the first place? The entire song is a plea to learn how to make fire himself and be just like humans. But step back for a second. Really think about it. What is he going to do with that fire? In a cut ending and in 2016's live-action remake, it's established that all the animals in the jungle are terrified of fire. If Louie had fire, what would he do? Give him the power of Man's Red Flower, and he could destroy the whole jungle, being a force even worse than Shere Khan. So yeah, Louie, potential arsonist, definite villain. In his team, it was a jazzy good time, and proves King Louie is the swingiest villain of all.
I wanna walk like you, talk like you, do woo woo. You see it's true, someone like me.
Fun fact, this is actually one of my favorite Disney songs in general, so yeah.
Yeah, can learn to be like someone like me. See, did bop bop bada doodle dot and dot and dot and dot and dot.
One of the more beloved Disney villains is Gaston. But why? Well, he's a living meme, first of all. But instead of having me explain why he's so beloved, let's let Gaston tell you why.
As you see, I've got biceps to spare.
The song Gaston is such an atypical villain song, but that's what makes it so great. He's not a villain in the traditional sense, since everyone in the town loves him. This song is just everyone singing about how great he is, which is kind of frightening knowing how much of an irredeemable asshole he is. It's dark and sinister while actively not trying to be dark and sinister. And it's so much fun to boot. I mean, it has
four dozen eggs!
Plus, it's the only Disney song where the sidekick gets large! I wonder what happened if Gaston was voiced by Patrick Warburton. Can you imagine?
Here's what I don't get, chum. The Immortal talks about the hardships of growing up poor and dyslexic. He lists all the incredible things that he's done, and yet nowhere in his book does he mention the fact that he's dead.
What are you talking about? He just died.
Huh?
That's what happens, Tick. One minute you're alive, you're a hero to the whole world, a hero to me. The next poof, you're dead.
Oh, come on, chum. You make it sound like it can happen to anybody.
Well, who do you think it happens to?
Well, you know, dead people.
Nope.
Oh god, no!
Well, you knew this was coming. After months and months of obsessing over this song, it's time to finally explain why I love Shiny so damn much. First, the WTF factor. When I first saw Moana, I had no idea this song or Tamatoa even existed. That's the power of great marketing that doesn't give away everything in the trailers. It also helps that this song is batshit insane, featuring a giant coconut crab singing a Bowie-inspired musical number written by Lin-Manuel Miranda. It's ridiculous, it's catchy as hell, it's funny, and it's also intimidating. Despite being such a goofy song, this is still the only Disney villain song where the villain is actively kicking the shit out of the hero as they sing it. Not using pussy-ass magic like Jafar, Tamatoa is tearing Maui apart as he sings about how fabulous he is. That's honestly incredible.
Tamatoa comes right out of nowhere. He's mentioned out the cup at one point during the traveling scenes, and then boom, giant army crab.
Attack its weak point for massive damage.
It's a catchy song and quite different from most Disney songs in general. It somewhat captures the dark vibe of a villain song, while also still managing to have an upbeat and jovial tone. If you're only just listening to the song and not watching the movie, you wouldn't even know this was supposed to be a villain song until the second half when Tamatoa tries to literally murder Maui. Also, he's voiced by the Collab from Rick and Morty. So does this make Maui a moon man?
Well, he lasted the sun, so it's not completely out of the question.
Oh, okay, cool.
When Moana came out, we hadn't had a real villain song for 6 years. And we hadn't had a good villain song for 7 years. Shiny not only delivered in spades, but it gave us one of the greatest musical sequences in ages. Ages! To me, this song is better than anything Frozen has to offer, Let It Go included. And I'm one of the people who really likes Let It Go. It's a highlight of the film music-wise, story-wise, character-wise, just everything about it works, from the bizarre opening to the trippy blacklight ending that harkens back to Disney classics like Dumbo. It's easily one of my top 10 favorite Disney songs of all time. And we're not even done with the list yet!
Well, I certainly wasn't prepared for this one.
I'm just gonna cut to the chase. Be Prepared is villainous perfection. The instrumentals, the grimy green colors, Jeremy Irons' insanely devious voice. From beginning to end, this song is absolutely captivating. And what makes this song even better is the fact that shortly after singing it, Scar actually accomplishes the shit that he sets out to do. Now that's dedication.
The lights are not all on upstairs. But we are talking kings and successions. Even you can't be caught unaware.
Yeah, there's not much left to say that hasn't been said about the song already. It's right up there with Poor Unfortunate Souls and just how well known it is. You could say that Poor Unfortunate Souls is the blueprint for villain songs, but Be Prepared is that formula perfected. And it has xylophones! Actually, yeah, that is the one oddity with the song. Its instrumentation is a bit unorthodox for the tone it sets, but it still works surprisingly well. Also, Mufasa is dead, get over it.
Be prepared. Yes, our teeth and ambitions are bared. Be prepared.
Now here's some honorable mentions, which some of them we couldn't include due to the criteria listed at the beginning of the video, and some of them just barely didn't make the cut. It's Gonna Get Weird from Gravity Falls.
You're Only Second Rate from Aladdin 2 Return of Jafar.
It's Our House Now from House of Mouse.
Headless Horseman from Ichabod and Mr. Toad.
Siamese from Lady and the Tramp.
Court of Miracles from Hunchback of Notre Dame.
Heffalumps and Woozles from Winnie the Pooh and the Blustery Day.
The World's Greatest Criminal Mind from Great Mouse Detective.
My Lullaby from Lion King 2, Simba's Pride.
Seagrove Survival from The Wind in the Willows.
Shiver My Timbers from Muppet Treasure Isle. Also, I don't hate Mother Knows Best, it's just very overrated. Don't kill me.
Well, what do you guys think number one is? Take a guess. I'll give you a few seconds. Okay, you got it?
Love's an Open Door from Frozen?
Boy.
It's Hellfire.
Beata Maria, you know I am a righteous man. Of my virtue I am justly proud.
Yeah, you saw this one coming, didn't you? On all accounts, Hellfire is the pinnacle of Disney villain songs. Nothing even comes close to it yet in terms of quality, animation, story, or just the sheer power of the song itself.
I feel her, I see her, the sun caught in her raven hair is blazing in me out of all control.
It also works as a nice supplement to Heaven's Light, which was the song from before just moments ago that you already forgot about. You go from light and hope to fire and anger. And if you know me, you know I just love fire.
This song pulled absolutely no punches in terms of what can be accomplished in a G-rated animated film. Lust, prejudice, eternal damnation, it's all here in one batshit insane package. This song is not only the pinnacle of Disney, it's the pinnacle of villain songs in general. I haven't come across anything in my extensive musical theater background that can match the sheer power, weight, and intensity of Hellfire.
Siren, cast her spell, don't let her fire sear my flesh and bone. Destroy Esmeralda, and let her taste the fires of hell, or else let her be mine and mine alone.
But you guys already know all of this. The song is number one on everybody's list. Everything that has been said about it has pretty much already been said by everybody else on the internet. Yet it deserves all the attention it gets. It's a great song, and this sequence is one of the best moments in the entire film. There's not much else to say. Hellfire is one fire we'd all like to bask in forever.
But she will be mine, or she
is our top 10 Disney villain songs.
I hope you agreed with Shiny being so high, because that's all the only correct answer.
James, I'm going to kill you. Do you agree with all our choices? Or is a song that got left off that you would like to see included? Besides Mother Knows Best and Love's Open Door, those don't count.
I don't hate Mother Knows Best.
We don't hate them, they're just overrated.
Let us know in the comments if Shiny should have been number one.
If you haven't seen it yet, watch our previous collab. We talk about Mario Kart for about 40 minutes.
I see you records and you see you at Batman's never face.